cork blocks have been cut and ready to be glued on. You can see how I cut them to the contour of both the rib and the bottom board. And we'll glue those on. And it will then be ready to proceed. I've glued up the high density cork onto the breast area of the decoy. And while I don't want to bore you with a lot of the details, there's a couple of tricks that I've learned when doing this kind of things that makes it helpful. First of all, I start off with some 3-inch high density cork that I buy at the duck blind, a different duck blind from Willie. And he has a site on the internet, carving supplies, decoy supplies, things like that. But I get the cork from him. It comes in 24 by 36 inch sheets, and you can get it in various thicknesses. I like to use the 3-inch because I can use it for various other things and build up the widths or the thickness with the use of bottom boards or these center ribs. It just adds, I don't think there's a whole lot of need for anything wider than that, because then you have a lot of fall off. Basically what I do is I've cut it into strips that's suitable for decoy sizes. In this case, I go ahead and mark it. I put it up against the center frame and the bottom board. I mark it, I cut it on the bandsaw, and then I glue it in place. Now, what I do, and I've glued these on with the West system, what I want to show you is I clamp it in two different directions in order to get a good bond to it. But what I do is I save the fall off that I use from the bandsaw from the blocks, and I use it as a caul to glue it on. Now, a lot of times if you use the caul, you got to kind of hold it in place and various things like that. But one of the tricks that I've learned is I stick it on with duct tape, the pieces that I cut off. That way I'm not trying to hold them in place while I'm clamping it. And so it's really like clamping a square piece that's already been cut. But it makes good for that. Now, one thing I want to also show you is when I clamp it on, don't put your caul directly on as it came off. Slide it up just a little bit away from any glue joint. And then I've also broke that little piece off so that it's not anywhere near where I'm gluing, because when you do that, you have a good chance of gluing your caul to your work. So slide it up just a little bit so that you got room, but then plenty of surface. Now, the good thing about the caul that comes from the dunnage is because it has the same fit, you're going to get a good distribution of the clamping pressure across that entire piece. I'll take this one off too. As you can see, that when after you clamp it, that duct tape holds pretty good. Now, so not only do I clamp it this way with a bar clamp, then I also take these wide grip clamps, and actually you can do it a couple ways. You can actually just clamp it to itself like that, or as you do like I, or as I did on this last one, I actually clamped it to the bench. Now, thing you got to worry about again is when you're going to put pressure on this, and you don't really require a lot of pressure with the West system, but I do try to put some pressure onto it so that it gets up in the voids of the cork. But I do like to keep pressure on it so that I get it adhered to the center board and also to the bottom board equally. Because if you do just put pressure on it this way with your bar clamp, it has a tendency, because the cork is soft, it has a tendency to want to pull, and it will actually pull up from that bottom board. So that clamp, the hand clamps, actually hold it down to the bottom board. So once again, those are just some tricks that I've learned. The West system is extremely tough, extremely durable. That's not coming off. It's waterproof. It's overkill. Wood glue works well. Another type of, and be sure you use tight bond 3 or another waterproof wood glue. Another glue that works good supposedly for the cork, and I never use it, is the expanding polyurethane glue, Gorilla Glue. and because it expands into the voids of the cork, which is what you want. Those are some tips and techniques for gluing on the cork. This is now ready to shape. You can shape it with a fillet knife to get the shape to the general size that you want. You can use a rasp, and then you can use coarse sandpaper. I do also want to show you just a little bit about a sanding device that I made. I can't claim its design, it's just one I've copied, made it a little bit better, and that is a contour sanding stick. It uses a 1-inch belt sanding belt for a belt sander. I don't remember the exact length of this, but it's really not important because you can take and you make your stick to fit the belt. This is a 1x4 oak that I had left over. What I tried to do is it fits on there like this. Normally you can put a piece of one of these Velcro straps along it or around it here to hold it tight. I found that's really just a little unnecessary. I basically just hold it and you can choke up on it to where you keep that belt tight. Now what this does with this recess right here is that allows it to form to the shape of what you're sanding so that you avoid flat edges. And then the good part about it is when you wear that particular piece of your sandpaper out, rotate it around until you come to a fresh piece, and then either re-velcro it, or like I said, you just hold it like that. Now, I put a place to drill the hole to hang it up, and I also put a magnet, countersunk a magnet into it so I can stick it on my bench. I found that really doesn't work real well. That magnet's not strong enough, but you know, it's an option that you always have. But that right there, after you get your cork basically rough shaped with a rasp, fillet knife, sharp knife, whatever you use, then that is a good method to sand it and round it. One thing I do want to say, when you're working with a knife on cork, and then one of the reasons why I recommend the fillet knife is because the blade is thin, you're able to take off long slivers without putting that sliver that you're cutting off into a bind. So when you're working with cork, thinner is better. So a fillet knife, if as long as it's sharp, works real well. And I use a Rapella fillet knife. It's got a good sharp blade in it. You can sharpen it, and so it works real well. I'm just going to mark a curve in here to replicate the curve of the breast of the goose. You may or may not be able to see it, but these aren't quite the same height. I'll easily take care of that by taking this side down, but I got to kind of take that into account when I establish my curve, because as I bring that down, that will actually broaden this area. That will actually broaden this area right in here. So, but I've kind of got to, you know, it's just a guideline anyway, but I've got it kind of pleasing and how I think it should be with a pencil. Now, just so while I'm actually using a rasp or draw knife or fillet knife, make it easier to see, and go in there with a Sharpie. And establish it where it can be seen rather easily. That gives me a good wide shelf to mount the head on, which is going to be this area right in here. So it's gave me plenty of room. And besides, you know, this, believe it or not, nothing in nature is flat and nothing is symmetrical. If you don't believe me, look at half of your face in the mirror and try to match it up with the other half, and they won't look alike. So it doesn't have to be perfect. It just has to be close and needs to be round.
Go make some shavings. You'll feel better.